So the last presentation of the day. It's quite hot here, so thank you for accepting to continue this process. That was up to now very interesting and very useful to me. I mean, this interaction between different way of viewing problems associated to deep decision under deep uncertainty. In fact, it's quite interesting to see many people really trying to go down to the decision, from theory to down to the decision. And I've been trying to do something similar in one very specific dimension, which is the problem of the discount rate. Okay, so I would like to give you a flavor of what I've been done over the last 20 years in that specific domain. I'm a decision theorist by training. I do a lot of things outside expected utility, but for normative problems, I'm Savagian. I use discounted subjective discounted expected utility as the criterion to determine what should be done collectively in the face of risk and uncertainty. So the deep problem I'm examining here is what's our responsibility toward future generation? What should be done? And there are many ways to improve the world for the future generation. You can try to fight climate change. You can try to invest in infrastructure, improve education, reduce inequalities, and that's the list goes on and on. And most of those decisions are taken by you and me. I mean, by entrepreneurs and by states. I will mostly focus on decisions by states. Because that's the question I typically tends to answer. I mean, what should be the discount rate to be used by public services around the world? So this is the problem of determining the discount rate is dual to the question of what's our responsibility toward future generation in a decentralized economy. The determination of the discount rate use, which is at the end of the day on markets, the interest rate for risk-free project. That's the way we decentralize the decision problem that determines what's the sacrifice or our generation do for future generations. So our sacrifices are what's the share of the wealth we produce every year devoted to saving and investment rather than consumption by yourself. As has been said several times today, I mean, people are out there already deciding about those things. They are not waiting for us, the jury, to make the decision. I feel that very strongly. I mean, for example, myself, I've been working with the French government about what the discount rate should be used in France in public services. And tomorrow morning, I couldn't attend this meeting because I have another meeting where people are discussing what change the discount rate should be used in France. And I'm quite in a minority at this stage in the decision process, and I would like to put some more weight on my position in those meetings. So sorry about that. So it's a really practical problem. I mean, at the end of the day, we need to get to a number. What discount rate should we use? Is it either 1%, 3%, 5%? At the end of the day, people have to make a decision. Okay. So we can talk a lot about whether to introduce regret or ambiguity aversion. At the end of the day, we need to agree, or maybe not. I mean, I personally have to make a recommendation, and you will see the kind of decision process I use to get to this recommendation. So, but standard cost-benefit analysis that is used by people, in particular by state, to make decision about whether to build a new fast train line between Toulouse and Paris, they are using cost-benefit analysis. And this cost-benefit analysis use a discounting system. Okay, and typically discounting system contains two elements, risk-free rate, that is the discount rate that should be used to discount safe cash flow, and the risk premium. That is by how much you need to increase the risk-free rate to determine a risk-adjusted discount rate to take into account of the riskiness of the project. and its impact on intertemporal welfare. Okay, so the level of the risk-free rate and the level of risk premium determine how much we should sacrifice the present for the future and how much risk we will force future generation to bear. Okay, and so these two things are normative parameters. They are partly determined by markets, but maybe the markets are not efficient enough to aggregate those individual preferences to generate that, and there are a lot of reasons to believe that markets don't do that efficiently, in particular in an overlapping generation framework, and future generation are not here to trade with us, and therefore their preferences are not included into the market price. So there is a deep question about whether the action that we are performing today, fighting climate change, making those long-term infrastructure investments, are they desirable? Or in more deeply, I mean, are they compatible with the maximization of some global objective? Okay, I'm an economist, so typically when I raise this question, when I examine this question of efficiency, I first ask what's the objective function. Okay, and of course, in this intertemporal dimension, and here if we think about climate change, intergenerational framework, we face deep uncertainty. So what are our responsibility to our future generation, given the deep uncertainty we face about what the environment of those guys will be? And that's a difficult question. Okay. And so here is a quote that I like. I would like to submit it to you by Baumol, 1968. You see, so the few topics in our disciplines rival the social rate of discount as a subject exhibiting simultaneously a very considerable degree of knowledge and a very substantial level of ignorance. So I think it's relevant to our group to think this combination of knowledge and ignorance into the same problem. And I think today we could exactly say the same thing. There is still a lot of debate and non-consensus among economists about what discount rate should be used for the very long run. In that environment, I've been working with the French government, but also with the UK, Norway, the Netherlands, and the US, discussing about their discounting system. So for France, just to give you an idea, until 2005, the discount rate was 8%. So whatever the maturity, whatever the risk, all public projects need to be evaluated using a discount rate of 8%. And in 2005, the Prime Minister asked Mr. Lebeg to write a report with a committee, with the Commissaire General au Plan, to propose a new system. And I was a member there. That was my first time I did that. The Commission recommended reducing the discount rate from 8% to 4%. But making the point that we should care about the riskiness of the project when we evaluate them. And so the risk, the 4% should be considered the risk-free rate. On top of that, we need to consider taking into account the riskiness of the project. But the problem is that report did not say anything about how to do that. And so in 2011, I was asked by the Prime Minister at that time to write another report about how to take into account of risk in the evaluation of public projects, exactly the question we are discussing here these days. And so I came, for 1 year, I organized meetings with my commission and 40 people with lobbyists from different sectors and a few academics. That's the French way of proceeding in those processes. And we came with the reports and that basically recommended using the consumption-based capital asset pricing model. That is, let us use a risk-free rate and adjust the risk-free rate by adjusting for the risk, measuring the risk of the project by a beta, which is the elasticity of the benefits of the project to change in aggregate consumption, measuring by what's the contribution of the project to the macroeconomic risk. And add to the risk-free rate, risk premium, which is the product of this beta by a systematic risk premium, which was proposed in that report to be 3%. I will talk later on about some details, for example, whether those risk-free rate and risk premia should be a function of the maturity of the project. So I don't want to go into the detail. The point is France these days is the only country in the world that uses a risk adjustment discount rate. In the US, they've been using a single discount rate of 7% for the last 20 years. There is for sensitivity analysis, they propose to, on top of using the 7%, look at what happened when you use the 3% discount rate. What's the meaning of that? That's not completely clear. In Norway, in the UK, they use also something like 4% decreasing term structure for that single risk-free rate, not risk-adjusted. Okay, to give you an idea of the importance of discounting when we make cost-benefit analysis, let me go back to the climate change problem. So you see here in the famous reports of the performed by the service of the White House last year. So you get a schedule for the price of carbon. The dollars per ton of CO2 that express the net present value of the expected damages generated by one ton of CO2 emitted today. Okay, and that price should grow over time for different reasons. I don't want to go into the details. The problem is, in order to estimate the present value of those marginal damage, you need to use a discount rate. And so, although I told you the US, the discount rate is 7%, in the report they didn't use 7%. So they didn't make the choice. And so they proposed three different discount rates. The 3%, which was used officially as a sensitivity analysis element, or 5% or 2.5%. And so you see how important is the choice of the discount rate in the determination of the price of carbon. Of course, a larger discount rate implies you value less the future, your responsibility toward the future is smaller, and the price of carbon will be smaller, and therefore there will be less effort to fight climate change. So, why do we value less the future than the present? Okay, that's ethical, moral, and economic question all at the same time. There is one fundamental argument: we discount the future. Okay, and this argument is very simple. It's important to understand it before we go to take into account of uncertainty. Okay, and the argument goes as follows: In a growing economy, investing for the future is crazy. Right? That means asking the poor, us, to sacrifice our consumption for the benefits of people who will be much wealthier than us. Remember that we have been growing by 2% per year over the last two centuries. That is, we are 50 times more wealthier than people who lived 200 years ago. Okay, and if we continue to believe that we will grow at 2% per year, in 200 years from now, those people from whom we are asked to make effort, sacrifice for reducing the risk of climate change, they will be 50 times wealthier than us. Okay, and even, you know, Trump is contemplating the possibility that the US economy will grow at 3% per year. So it's not 50 times wealthier, that's 200 times wealthier. So why should we care about climate change? Okay, so the discount rate should be interpreted from that idea. It should be interpreted as the minimum rate of return of a project, of a risk-free project, in fact, that compensates for the fact that investing for the future increases intergenerational inequalities. Okay, so investing for the future has this adverse effect of increasing intergenerational inequality, asking the current poor to finance the wealth of the future wealthy people. And so that's generated, that has a negative impact on intergenerational welfare. And that's, however, the project, the investment project could be socially desirable. It could increase the intergenerational welfare if the rate of return of the project is large enough. And so the discount rate is this minimum threshold for the rate of return of the project that induces that the project increase intergenerational welfare in spite of the fact that it increases inequalities. So there are two ingredients here. Okay, one ingredient is growth. We should believe in growth. Okay, and we should recognize that one of the biggest aspirations in our society is to reduce inequalities. But here it's intergenerational inequalities I'm talking about. Okay, and in fact, the very basic equation in economics proposed by Frank Ramsey, we were talking about Knight, here I'm talking about Ramsey, almost same time, 1928, proposed a very simple rule that exactly combines, simply translate into a simple equation, this idea that I just developed on this slide. And this Ramsey equation just tell you that this minimum rate of return for a risk-free project that is necessary to compensate the negative impact of this investment on intergenerational inequality is given by the product of two elements, a degree of inequality aversion, okay, that's a moral ethical parameter, and the growth rate of the economy. And you see, the larger the growth rate of the economy, the less we should ask the current generation to do something, because it will induce to use a larger discount rate, and therefore we less investment project will pass the test of a positive net present value. And same thing for inequality aversion. The larger the inequality aversion, the less we should care about future generation because we are so poor. And inequality aversion implies that we should not do a lot for those very wealthy guys in the future. So that's the idea. So let us calibrate this equation. I know that you will not like that, but just as a benchmark, okay? Just as a benchmark. Okay, so we need to care about two things, inequality aversion and prospective growth rate. Okay, inequality aversion, in front of my student, I used to present this very simple laboratory experiment where I confront my people in my room to the simple question. Suppose we live in a society where there are two social groups, a wealthy group and a poor group, and the wealthy people consume twice as much as the poor. Okay? And we are contemplating the possibility to transfer consumption from the wealthy to the poor, the right direction in this case. Okay? But the problem is that when we do that, as we know, there are some deadweight loss associated to incentives and all those things. So the question is, what's the minimum? Well, let me read this because there are many ways to ask this question, and let me stay in line with what is written there. What is the maximum sacrifice the wealthy group that society should accept for giving $1 for each member in the poor group? My objective is to transfer $1 to the poor group, a person in the poor group. What's the maximum amount of money I'm ready to remove from the one wealthy person to give $1 to this poor? Okay, if you tell me I'm not ready to sacrifice one more dollar under the veil of ignorance, I'm not ready that we should not ask more than $1 from the wealthy to give $1 to the poor, you are inequality neutral. You are not interested by inequalities. You didn't read Piketty's book, okay? if you tell me, oh, I'm ready to give up as much as $5 from the wealthy to give $1 to the poor, you are very well inequality averse. So depending upon your degree of inequality aversion, you will answer differently to that question. And so if you tell me, let me fix the idea. If you tell me that you are ready to give up as much as $4 from the wealthy to give $1 to the poor, your degree of inequality aversion, this number here is 2. Okay.
How is wealthy and poor defined in the question?
Excuse me?
How is wealthy and poor defined? It depends on tend southwards, if I'm going from the top half to the bottom half, probably much less if I'm going from the top 1%.
Yeah, I agree. So there are many. So yes, you can test about other questions, see whether it's compatible. Yeah, I fully agree with you that if I increase inequalities, the degree of inequality could matter. Here I assume implicitly a power utility function, in fact. Okay. Well, anyway, that's okay. So let me tell you that most people, most experts in the literature are proposing a degree of inequality inversion around 2. And in all my writing over the last 20 years, I used 2. Okay. So let me skip to this 2. Okay. So this means that the socially desirable discount rate is approximately equal to 2 times the growth rate of consumption. Okay? And so if you believe that we will continue to grow at 2% per year for the next 100 years, we should use 4% as the discount rate. Okay? And I answer the question. Okay? Well, and so to give you just a flavor of what people said about this degree of inequality inversion, what's their perspectives of growth rate, and what's their recommendation for the discount rate. Many people took a position on this, and that's the short summary that I wrote for the IPCC report number 5 related to that. Okay, not a surprise, you will tell me, oh, that's crazy, we need to take into account of the uncertainty affecting the growth rate of the economy. Of course, our responsibility toward future generations deeply depends upon how we describe the uncertainty related to this growth rate, okay? And that will be typically very important for the distant future. So growth is uncertain. And therefore, that should affect the way we translate our responsibility toward future generation into a number, this discount rate. In what direction? Well, that's easy. Think about yourself. Okay? Think about yourself, thinking about your sacrifice of your present welfare consumption for the improving of your own future welfare. How do you do that? You save. Okay? Saving is the perfect instrument for transferring consumption from the present to the future. And so think about yourself. What's the effect of the uncertainty affecting your future incomes on your decision to save, your decision to sacrifice the present for the benefits of the future? Well, in economics, that has been tested several times, thousands of times in the literature since the first time John Maynard Keynes proposed this notion of the precautionary saving motives. Okay? So we save because the future is uncertain. And the more uncertain is the future, the more we save. And you can check that when there is a wave of uncertainty about the future of the economy, people save more, and that tends to reduce the interest rate on the market because you flood the market with the liquidity of the saving coming from the household. Okay, so that's a universal observation, that we save more when there is more uncertainty, and we should do the same thing at the collective level. How do we do that at the collective level? Well, we induce more investment by reducing the discount rate. Okay, so uncertainty should induce us to reduce the discount rate. By how much? Well, that's where the problem is. No? What should I do? Let us continue. We should vote about that. Or okay, who is the risk analyst here? Okay. So if you make the assumption, if you take expected utility, if you take discounted expected utility, plus you assume a geometric Brownian motion for the growth rate of consumption, that's typical what is done in asset pricing theory, in finance. It looks quiet and not stressed, so let me continue. If you make this assumption... Okay, thanks. Who is responsible here?
Well, responsible just left.
So if you make this assumption, then you need to adapt this Ramsey formula into an extended Ramsey formula, which is just the initial one, this product of the inequality aversion by the growth rate of consumption, and reduce it by this number, which is half time the degree of inequality aversion squared, so 4, 2 squared here is 4, time the volatility, the variance of the growth rate of consumption. And so over the 20th century in the US and similar numbers for in the Western world, the volatility of the growth rate of consumption has been around 3% per year. Okay, so sigma around 3%. That's the measure of the uncertainty we face. That's how in asset pricing theory, people will measure the degree of riskiness associated to the macroeconomy. Okay, so sigma 3%, sigma squared 0.1%. Okay, so you take half time 4 times 0.1%, well, it's 0.2%. That's peanuts. Forget it. Okay, bad news for us. We are interested by risk, but risk is irrelevant to make decision about the future, to determine what's our responsibility for the future. The clear determinants is not risk. It's just the fact that we have inequalities across generation, and that's the determinant factor to determine the discount rate. End of the story, and too bad for us. Well, that's not true. That's not true because, of course, measuring the risk for the next two centuries, but just looking what happened over the last 50 years or something, measuring, you know, assuming that things evolve according the Brownian motion, that's make no sense to me. I mean, go to the movie. I mean, look at all those stories about, you know, the last days of the war and what happened in two centuries. People live in a very violent society and all those things. I mean, clearly, in our mind, that's not what we have. It's not a geometric Brownian motion. We believe there will be discontinuity, there will be catastrophes, maybe there will be marvelous things that will happen. We will conquer Mars, we will discover new drugs, we will reduce inequalities, everybody will be happy, and that will be heaven in the world. I don't know. So, and here, just to give you an idea, you know that historically, if just focusing about the last two centuries to measure what will happen to us for the next two or three or one millennium, I don't know. We know that the last two centuries have been very special in the prosperity of humankind of this planet. Like, I think if we want to project what will happen in the future, we need to go much further backward in the analysis of economic growth. Okay, remember, historians tell us that we farmers in France before the French Revolution did not consume more than a laborer under Nabucodonosor in Mesopotamia in 7 millennia ago. Okay, so zero growth over 7 millennia, and then boom, increase by a factor 50 over two centuries. So from this history, we should recognize that we don't know much about what will happen in the future. Many possible stories are possible, and we should recognize that. So that's what I have done in different papers over the last 10 years. The framework is always the same. I told you I'm Savagian, so I'm going to derive discount rates, risk premia, from a simple objective function, which is an intergenerational discount expected utility function. Okay, so in order to evaluate whether an action is desirable today, date zero, or not, I just examine whether this project increase or reduce W0. And W0 is just the expectation of the sum of future discounted utility of the different generation who will live on this planet. Okay, and in fact, I will put delta to zero on normative ground. I'm not racist, I'm not against women, and I'm not against people who will live on this planet in the future, so I put an equal weight, the utility of those people with respect to my utility. So delta is equal to zero. And so U, the concavity of U, represent at the same time risk aversion and inequality aversion. And you understand that these two things are important when we will make the calibration of the model.
So just a clarification, yeah. Delta is not your discount rate?
Delta is the rate of pure preference for the present. It describes the fact that you prefer immediate happiness than future happiness. And the discount rate I'm talking about is the way you penalize euros or dollars because they are not happening today, they are materializing in the future. So, yeah, I agree, there is...
The integral is not bounded.
Oh, yeah, it could be unbounded. So. Yeah, I should put a capital T on top of that. You know, what I'm going to do here, and I will not go into the technical details. In fact, that will be the only technical slide in my presentation. What I'm going to do is suppose that you have a project. Suppose that you have a project that forces to reduce C0 by 1 today, and that allow to increase consumption at some specific day t by some amount, okay? And let us see whether this very simple marginal project increase or reduce. So what happened before and after is not relevant. So I just want to look at a very simple benefit occurring 2 centuries. So suppose you have the possibility today to do something that will increase consumption by your by the person who will live on this planet in 129. Okay, how should we value that? So, okay, but you are right. Technically, there may be a difficulty with the boundedness of the objective function. So, more generally, in fact, I'm going to examine a project that has reduced consumption today by 1 and an increased consumption at some dt by ct at the power beta. So in fact, beta, for those who did a little bit finance here, that's the Kappen beta. That's the elasticity of the benefits of your project to change in the aggregate consumption. Okay, you can put that beta to 0. It's a risk-free project. Give you 1 in the future. How much would you value a sure amount of rise, for example, occurring 2 centuries from now? Okay, so that's exactly what I do here, you see. I examine how this project affects, so you invest in epsilon is the dimension of the intensity of your investment. So you look at how this project where you increase consumption by this at dt, how whether that increase or reduce this W0 at d0. Okay, and you suppose it's a marginal project that does not affect your beliefs about the growth of the economy. And so, in fact, this question of whether this project increases or reduces welfare is equivalent, it can be simplified into just a problem of measuring whether the net present value of the project is positive or negative. So you see the link between cost-benefit analysis and social welfare function. Okay. What is good from this model is you see how you can derive from the objective function a simple, quote-unquote, simple formula to determine what discount rate should be used to compute the discounted value of the flow of expected benefits. And so this discount rate is a function of the risk profile. In fact, it's a function of beta. It's a risk-free rate plus a risk premium. Okay, and the risk-free rate and the risk premium are given by this thing. So if you give me the UTT function, if you give me the stochastic process for CT, that is your collective beliefs about the growth of the economy, I'm able to compute these integrals, those expectations, and I'm able to give you the term structure of the risk-free rate and the term structure of the risk premium. So that is what is done in asset pricing theory, in fact. And in fact, if you plug a geometric Brownian motion for CT, you get exactly the Ramsey rule that I presented earlier, okay, for the risk-free rate. Okay, so by the way, if you do that, so if you use constant relative risk aversion, so a power UTT function and a geometric Brownian motion, the term structure for the risk-free rate will be flat. That is, If it's optimal to use 4% to discount the cash flows occurring in next year, it's also optimal to use 4% to discount the cash flows occurring two centuries from now, 4% per year, I mean. And so that has been very much criticized, particularly by Marty Weizmann, who came with an argument, a bad argument, but anyway, an argument to use a smaller discount rate for, he's my co-author, so I should not say too much about him. To use a smaller discount rate for the more distant future. And that would be good, of course, to increase our responsibility toward future generation. More, we will bias our investment toward risk-free project with long maturities. Okay, so I want to spend some time on this question. So now at this stage I didn't talk a lot about deep uncertainty. I just assume geometric Brownian motion, and I told you I don't think it's a good representation of our beliefs about the long-term destiny of humankind on this planet. Okay, we should take into account of something more. So, and there are many ways to do that. Markov process, catastrophes, mean reversion. Here I will take a very simple model. Okay, it's related to a paper I published last year in Journal of Monetary Economics, where in fact I assume that the yearly growth rate is IID. Okay, so the growth rate of consumption is IID over time, so there is no serial correlation in growth rate. I don't think that's true, but at least that provides an initial punchline for this question. But what I do is I assume that I don't know the distribution of this IID random variable. So I know there is no serial correlation, but I don't know the density function, the PDF, of the growth rate of consumption. I will learn about that by just observing year after year the growth rate of consumption, the outcome of this extracting the growth rate from this unknown urn. And you see, I so there is ambiguity here, but I don't assume ambiguity aversion. And let us see what's this socially desirable in this world where I depart from a known geometric Brownian motion to an unknown geometric Brownian motion, or even more generally to an unknown process, IID process, not necessarily Gaussian. Okay, and there will be an illustration at the end about that. So here is I don't have much time about that. So. Just to tell you, I will not go into the details of the example. So in fact, the repetition, playing the Ellsberg game more than once implied that the ambiguity neutral person will play in an ambiguity averse way. Okay. In fact, introducing uncertainty about the composition of the urn generates some serial correlation in the outcome of drawing with replacement ball from the urn. Okay, typically, if you get the good news in short run, getting a ball that generates good news, well, that's good news for the future. You will update your beliefs using the Bayesian rule, and so that generates positive serial correlation in your subjective beliefs about the composition of the urn. And so that magnified the long-term risk. Okay, so to get it short, that means that in the discounted expected utility model, you will behave and you will value things in an ambiguity-averse way, in a sense, due to the repetition of the same extraction of the ambiguous urn. And so in here you have a simple example of that. I have no time to go into the details. And here is another illustration of that. So suppose that you face a geometric Brownian motion, but you don't know the trend. You know the volatility of your process, you don't know the trend. And here is in this example, the trend is either 1% with probability 1/2 or 3% with probability 1/2. And let us see what's the density function for the log of consumption in 1 year from now, in 10 years from now, in 100 years from now, in 200 years from now. And so the plane curve is the true density function given the ambiguous trend, and the dashed curve corresponds to what you will obtain as a PDF when you replace the unknown trend by its mean. Okay, and so you see that replacing a sure trend of 2% by an uncertain trend of 1% or 3%, you don't change the mean, but you magnify, you increase the weight in the tails of the distribution enormously. Okay, meaning this ambiguity on the trend does not change the risk in the short run, almost nothing, but for the long run, it makes the future so much uncertain, not knowing whether the growth, the trend will be 1% or 3%, play a much bigger role than just the standard volatility around the trend to express the uncertainty we face about that distant future. And then you already know the answer to what's the consequence of introducing this parametric uncertainty into the model on the way we should discount the future. Okay, remember, the uncertainty tends to reduce the discount rate. And of course, the larger the uncertainty about the future, the smaller the discount rate should be. And because you see that the uncertainty becomes bigger and bigger coming from parametric uncertainty, bigger and bigger when you go to the more distant future, that implies that we should use a decreasing term structure, as suggested by Marty Weizmann, but for a good reason now. Yes, what I just explained for the risk-free rate, you can do the same thing for risk premium. And the idea is very simple. Here you, exactly for the same reason as we should have a decreasing term structure for the risk-free rate, we should also have an increasing term structure for risk premium. Because this parametric uncertainty magnifies the long-term risk, and therefore, any project which is positively correlated with the aggregate consumption will also see the riskiness or the contribution to the macro riskiness enlarged too. And therefore, because I'm risk averse, I should penalize this project more, particularly those with long maturities. And therefore, I should have an increasing term structure for risk premia. So here are different, let me use my last 4 minutes, maybe three, okay, giving you two simple examples. One is, I already gave you the idea for uncertain trend. Let me switch to uncertain volatility, okay? I forget about this first bullet, I have no time to present. Let me just give you an extreme example from also Marty Weizmann, I'm sorry about that, but a very good paper published in American Economic Review in 2007 that got a lot of attention. And that's very interesting because it tells, if you depart from the standard asset pricing model that I summarized earlier in my presentation, where you assume CRRA plus geometric Brownian motion, so you are in the Gaussian world, everything is perfect, you get risk-free rate, risk premium, okay. Suppose now that you don't know the volatility. You know the trend, you don't know the volatility. Okay, so what would you do? You would estimate the volatility by looking at the past, assuming an informative prior. You will get the beta distribution for inverted gamma distribution for the posterior distribution for the risk premium. And if you combine that with the normal distribution, the conditional normal distribution, you get the student. So that's statistic 101. Okay? And just replacing the normal distribution for the growth rate of consumption by a student, whatever the degree of freedom you get, okay, you always get a risk-free rate that goes to minus infinity and a risk premium that goes to plus infinity. So you solve the puzzle in finance, where you, the standard model gives us a too large risk free rate. Here you get a too low risk free rate, minus infinity, that's not good. And a too large risk premium get plus infinity rather than a too low risk premium. As in Gaussian case, that does not happen. You get. Yeah, but that's not finite. Well, not infinite, of course. Will you take any finite degree of freedom, you get those extreme. When the degree of freedom goes to infinity, you get back to Gaussian. Oh, no, in time. No, the degree of freedom is determined by the number of observations you have. Here, the number of observations you have is given. Yeah, in plus infinity from now, you will learn the sigma, and okay. You will be back in the Gaussian world. But we cannot wait until this time to happen to make this. So that's an illustration of the importance of the deep uncertainty, such as parametric uncertainty on the volatility, on the way we should make recommendation about how we value or responsibility toward future generation. Just departing from Gauss to student make a problem. Here is a less extreme present example where, again, I go back to a certain trend and I take the very simple. So I assume normal, conditional normal, but the trend is unknown. And don't ask me why. Assume that the trend is either 0.8% per year with probability 1/2 or 2% with probability 1/2. Okay. If you make this assumption together with assuming that there is no preference for the current generation, delta equals zero, degree of inequality version of 2, and conditional volatility of 2%. This is the discount rate for risk-free projects we should use for maturities up to 150 years. So you start from the 4% that I announced earlier in the early slide of my presentation, and you go down basically to 0%. Okay, so you got other risk-adjusted discount rate for different betas. You know this elasticity of the benefits of your project to aggregate consumption, and you can see that indeed the risk premium is increasing with maturity. Okay, and you can improve things by allowing for serial correlation in the process, mean reversion. You get slide like that. I have no time to, and let me know. I have 1 minute and 30 seconds? Okay. Okay.
With the discount rate of 4.
Okay. So there is another interesting branch of the recent literature on asset pricing that demonstrates that introducing catastrophes, macroeconomic catastrophes, to the beliefs of the representative agent can also solve the puzzles in finance. Okay. The big name in this literature is Robert Barrow. And so what he does typically is, let me assume that the annual growth rate of consumption is a mixed normal. Okay? There is a standard normal earned business as usual, where the trend is, where the trend is 2.5% and volatility 2%, so similar to what I was presenting earlier. But there is another catastrophic earn. Okay, and the catastrophic earn is also normal with the mean of big loss of almost 40% expected reduction in consumption and a very large volatility, a very large uncertainty about what will actually happen. Okay, for different reasons, Barrow uses a much larger gamma, a much larger degree of inequality aversion of 4, and I don't like that either. He also uses a rate of pure preference for the presence of 3%. If he does that, and he, on top of that, if we assume that the probability of getting the yearly growth rate from the catastrophic earn is 1.7% per year, then you can solve the standard puzzle in finance and get the typical risk-free rate around 0 or 1% and the risk premium around 6%, as we have seen in the US for the last century. The problem is, how does Barrow estimate this 1.57%? How can we know that for the US economy, there will be a catastrophe like that every 50 years on average? Okay, what he does, he assumes that US is, as any other countries in the world, And so he can look at other catastrophes that happen in other countries. He collects data from 35 countries over 100 years. So he has 3,500 data observation, and on this observation, you observe 60 catastrophes like that. And therefore, 60 divided by 3,500 is 1.57%. But of course, that's crazy. I mean, there is a huge uncertainty about this probability. So what I did is in that paper, and I'm finished with this. I just one slide with the result there. Just recognize that I have an informative prior, and I collect this 60. I observe this data. What's my posterior? It's a beta distribution. So let me assume, let me recognize that I don't know the true probability of a catastrophe. It's beta distributed with this parameter there, that coming from my data. Okay, and so if I recognize this, and let me finish with this, I get crazy thing. I get that's huge. The impact of recognizing this uncertainty has huge effect on what should be the discount rate. And what should be the risk premium? So you see, for the risk-free rate, if I don't take into account of this uncertainty on the probability of catastrophes, I get the 0.5% as in Barrow. But if you recognize that this B, the probability of a catastrophe, is beta distributed, you get the yearly risk-free rate of -200%. Okay, -200%, meaning. As soon as you get for plus infinity, for very, very long maturities, millennium, okay? So if you have a risk-free project that gives you peanuts in 1 millennium with certainty, you should be ready to give up everything to go there, almost everything, okay? Using a discount rate of -200%, that's enormous. And symmetrically, for the risk premium, okay? Barrow is able, without recognizing the uncertainty and the probability, to get the what we observe on the financial market for the equity premium. Okay. Now, if you recognize that the probability of catastrophes is unknown with the beta distribution, you go not to up to 6%, you go to 63% per year. Also enormous. So meaning never take any long-term risk. Forget about making investment when you don't know the outcome of this investment for long maturities. And I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you. Very interesting talk. Is this on?
Yeah.
Okay. You have a very mature and sophisticated theory. I have nothing to add.
Yeah, that's a bad introduction.
Yes, but there's the key word, but. What you're talking about is not so different, although you're going to tremendous economic sophistication, from what I was talking about innovation dilemmas. And Shackle-Popper indeterminisms, the future has inherent surprises. And when you implement your model, you have to choose either parameters or actual distributions or parameters of those distributions. And while I'm sure you know, you've got this theory and you're very happy with it, I would info-gap it.
I'm not surprised.
big surprise, right? You know, I it's a beautiful theory, and I like it. So I would take it and embed it in an infogap robustness analysis.
I agree.
And say, you know, just at the very simplest level, if we go back just to your very first starting point, you know, Ramsey choose a risk averse of 2. Okay, 2 is my best guess. But let's infogap it and ask how, for any given analysis of welfare, for example, welfare if we do this or welfare if we do that, how wrong could Ramsey be? And Ramsey, of course, is not wrong at all, but he's dead. How wrong could Ramsey be policy A would still be better than policy A, B? So that you take this analysis at any level of sophistication and ask the robustness question.
What do you think about that? Turn it into a question.
I like it. That remains to be done. By myself, I work on extension of this Looking at ambiguity inversion, so I use smooth ambiguity inversion, seeing so I go from the discounted expected utility model to this KMM smooth ambiguity inversion model. I'm not very happy with this. I think you have a very important point, saying we need to check what happened when some extreme scenarios are realized, and how bad we can go if we make this assumption rather than that. And so sensitivity analysis for sure is something should be done. Okay. Something else that I did is departing from discounted expected utility to go to Krebs-Porteus. I mean, to recognize that risk aversion and inequality aversion are not the same thing. I'm not convinced. I didn't talk about that here because I'm not convinced. You know, philosophers in this room know that, you know, if we use the concept of the veil of ignorance, if I don't know in which generation I will be born, this intergenerational inequality is risk under the veil of ignorance, and so. Allowing risk aversion and inequality aversion to be different is recognizing that this inequality, which is risk under the veil of ignorance, has a different nature than risk. And that I'm not happy with this, but I would be glad to talk about that more extensively. But doing the kind of thing you propose, that should certainly be done. At the end of the day, you know, what I like in this model is it's transparent. So you put your beliefs in this set of distribution function, and you put your preference with this delta and this gamma, and you get numbers. And so people with whom I'm talking at in France tomorrow, in the US, in the UK, in Norway, they understand that. They know what I put into the model. Yeah, sure. But it's... Oh yes. I will talk a lot about whether we should use discounted expected utility. Well, we spend years. Those guys have been talking with me for years in the last 15 years about what discount rate should be used. And so eventually they understand the economics of the social welfare function and the origin of the welfarist approach of cost-benefit analysis. And I agree, it's a limited number of people outside academia. Yeah.
Well, it's just a kind of follow-up, actually, because it's very similar. I was about to say that I'm always uncomfortable about hearing you say we need a number. And in fact, we need a formula that gives a number out of the ingredients. And so it's a bit of a problem when countries decide on they do that, unfortunately. And they should, instead of having one number or two numbers, one for short term and one for long term, they should have a formula that incorporates assumptions about growth, about risk, about the beta of various investments, about the inequality, the future of inequality, and all these sort of things. Right?
That's exactly what I'm fighting about. And I fully agree with you. I'm not credible. I have no legitimacy in determining what the gamma should be. What's the degree of inequality aversion? I'm agnostic. I think if I would be the king of my country, I would use two as a representation of what I believe the social preference in my country. But I have no legitimacy on that. So that's why it's important to have a very transparent model that makes people understand the relationship between the ingredient we put into the models and what they get as a consequence. And it's very important in terms of coherence.
Jakob, Casey, do you want to come?
So just one more word on this. We are also interested by intragenerational inequality and the way we should value policies that reduce inequalities today. And it's important to use the same degree of inequality aversion across generation or intragenerationally. Yeah. And so coherence is very important.